How are you, Jenny?
Yeah. Nice dress.
How are you, Shannon? Yeah.
I'm talking to Jenny.
Yeah,
right now.
I'm talking to you.
You feel it? Oh.
I'm ready to go because we're about to talk about the Cowboys, and then we get to talk about LeBron James. And I would submit to you that LeBron missed those two free throws late in that game the other night because he was thinking about the Cowboys, his favorite team. They were playing at the same time. He was distracted by the Cowboys.
You win one game, and now you're out
crazy.
Here turning cartwheels and driving the... You driving that bus again, huh?
Me and LeBron.
No, I know you and LeBron.
Huh?
LeBron got other things to worry
he
about.
He does not. He loves the Dallas Cowboys.
No, he does
always
not.
Have. Hey, you're missing that
he
boat.
Likes the Cowboys.
Yep.
I get it.
Yep,
but
yep,
he wasn't
yep,
thinking
yep,
about
yep.
him Sunday
yes,
night.
Yes, he was.
No.
He was getting updates on the big win at Philly.
Okay.
Yep.
We are going to talk
short-lived.
About your guy, LeBron, Shannon, because is he maybe starting to feel the pressure playing in L.A.? And then what about Skip's guy, Kevin Durant?
Yeah.
He says he's the best player in basketball right now, but why is he fighting with his teammates?
Good question.
But as Skip set us up, let's start with the Cowboys. They're sitting at 4-5 after a big win Sunday night against the Eagles, but it's not going to get any easier for Dallas. They'll be an underdog on Sunday in Atlanta. After that, they have three straight home games against the division-leading Redskins, the 8-1 Saints, and another matchup against the Eagles. So, Skip.
Yes, ma'am.
Yesterday, you said that the Cowboys will win the NFC
I said that.
East.
Yes,
did
I did.
You did say that.
Mm-hmm.
Why did you say that?
Look, Jenny, Mr. Sharp, I am not completely sold on these Dallas Cowboys. In fact, I am far from it. I am the first to admit I still have not recovered from that rotten egg that they laid on Monday Night Football against the Tennessee Titans. I still don't completely trust them. But I still believe they will win the NFC East by default. If you want to tell me they will back into the NFC East and win the division title and make the playoffs by winning said title, you can tell me they're going to back in, but I think they're going to win it by default. So, first of all, I believe the Cowboys will lose Sunday at Atlanta. Atlanta opened as a 4.5-point favorite. It got bet down to 3.5. Why is that, Mr. Sharp? Because the Cowboy Nation bandwagon is rolling and people are jumping back on that bandwagon. I might be, but I just told you I don't completely trust it. And I say they're going to lose at Atlanta with their house of horrors last year where Dak Prescott got sacked 8 times, 6 by Adrian Claiborne. And I don't think it'll be that bad this time. I just think they're going to lose that game. I also think the Dallas Cowboys will lose 2 weeks from Thursday night at home to the New Orleans Saints. And I think you would agree with that. But I also believe that the Cowboys will avenge their robbery at Washington by beating the Redskins. It was a robbery. That penalty called on the false start on the flinch. He did not move the football. So they're going to avenge that game on Thanksgiving Day at Jerry World. And I believe they will beat the reeling Philadelphia Eagles for a second time on December 9th at Jerry World. So what you are missing the point on and the boat on is that I got 3 aces in the hole. The closing schedule of the Dallas Cowboys, the last 3 games, I think are highly winnable. And if they need to win those games to make the playoffs, I think they're going to win at Indy, Tampa Bay at home, at Giants. Did the Giants win last night at San Francisco? Are they dangerous? Could they be the spoiler in this division? No, they will not be.
No, absolutely not.
Okay, so I say Cowboys close with those 3 wins to get to 9-7. I think that's going to be the magic record in the NFC East because I believe the Redskins are going to lose this Sunday at home to a Texans team that has won 6 straight games. This is a swing game in the NFC East. It's a huge game for me and my Cowboys and maybe for the Eagles because I got to have DeSean Jackson go to Washington and win a game in a stadium in which Josh Norman said the other day at Tampa, you know, nobody roots for them at home. They get more support on the road. They got more support from their fans at Tampa than they get at home. I don't get that. Maybe that'll inspire them to root a little harder, but it seems like there's some dissension in the ranks and in the stands at Washington. So I say I got Texans winning that game. I got Washington losing at Cowboys, at Titans. That'd be no surprise. And then to the Eagles at home to close it out. That would make the Redskins 8-8. 9-7, better than 8-8. Yes, which brings me to the Philadelphia Eagles, the defending Super Bowl champs, have the toughest closing schedule in all of football. And I say they're going to lose at the Saints this Sunday. That would be no shock, would it? Saints are 7.5-point favorites in that game. Eagles lose at Dallas and at Rams. That would be no shock. And that would bring the Eagles to a closing record of 8-8. Dallas 9-7, Washington 8-8, Eagles 8. Ah! Dallas backs in. Guess what? You would lose your, what, how many cases? I don't know how many cases we got bet on that, but I think Dallas is going to win by default.
Whatever we got bet, I want to add two to it.
What is it? Three. Yeah. Three. I'll stand by three.
Okay.
Well, I'm sitting here at 4-5. Look, you want to talk about going on the end of the
list? You earned that record.
Yeah.
You earned it.
I did. We are what our record says we are. We're 4-5, and I don't completely trust.
Okay.
But I trust Dallas more than I trust Philly or Washington right now, especially looking at those schedules that I just detailed for you, and I think I just closed the case. Backed in.
I'm trying to figure, this is what I have a hard time understanding, and because you said, this is what you said. You're not sold on the Cowboys, but you're picking them to win the division anyway.
I just detailed it for you because the schedules are hard, man, but I think my schedule, I got those three aces in the hole at the end, and I think you're going to be sitting over there just sweating through your suit coat thinking, uh-oh, they're going to win. Again, Indy's won three in a row, but against really not much competition. But I still, Andrew Luck's bouncing back. He could be the comeback player of the year. Will it be a dicey game? Will it be a 50-50? I just think they can win that. I think they can beat Tampa, and they can beat the Giants at the Giants.
I'm going to get to my other point later. Will the Cowboys still win the NFC? Absolutely not, Jenny. That's not going to happen. I got them over the next four games going 1-3.
Okay.
Which will end this foolishness.
Okay.
This foolery.
It could be.
Yeah. This debauchery that you got going on now all of a sudden.
Debauchery. I've got lots of debauchery.
Yeah, you do.
I got some debauchery. Maybe,
yeah, but all that. You done threw the jersey in the trash. You done threw the hat in the trash. Mm-hmm. You were done with that.
I pulled it out.
Now
I've dusted it off.
That is
Skip,
true.
Here's the thing. What I have a hard time understanding is that how can you have so much confidence in a team that have yet to score 20 points back-to-back games?
Good question.
Okay, well, you
and you still got confidence in the Eagles? Yeah. Or are you on the Redskins bandwagon?
No. We're not talking
about... I like Alex Smith. I fear Alex Smith. Check down Alex. I fear him.
I just ask you a simple question.
Yep.
Feel free to respond. Mm-hmm. How and why do you have so much confidence in the Cowboys when they have yet to score 20 in back-to-back games?
Can I go?
Yeah, just say
thank you. So, on Sunday night at Philadelphia, I saw flashes in every area of football that showed me just how good this Dallas team can be. I saw Jason Garrett, Coach Clapp, go for it on 4th-and-2 from his 31 with a fake punt, and I love that because it worked and it inspired the football team. I saw Scott Linehan, whose job I've been calling for, call a series of clever, inspired plays, especially in the red zone, that shocked me because he pulled his head out and looked like 2014 Scott Linehan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I saw a Dak Prescott look awful in some series, look shell-shocked, look gun-shy, look double-pumping hesitant. And I saw him turn around in three long drives, two in the fourth quarter, and be the playmaking driving force of my offense. I saw the best of that.
You're making my point for me. It's the inconsistency.
Okay.
What did you see on Monday night?
I saw Amari Cooper finally give them a legitimate, bona fide wide receiver threat who can separate and force double coverage and suddenly free up Cole Beasley and Michael Gallup and Allen Hurns for wide open catches.
Okay.
Because he's a stud. He was the fourth pick in the draft, and he's a two-time Pro Bowler, and they haven't had it all year. He's changing the way they play football.
Okay.
And I saw an offensive line on Sunday night by Hook or Crook, and again, I don't wish injury on anybody, so I'm knocking on wood, but Connor Williams has been a liability as a rookie left guard, and he couldn't play on Sunday night. And all of a sudden, what did I tell you about Hudson Houck? The best offensive line coach I've ever been around came out of retirement in the bye week to try to fix the offensive line. And it suddenly got fixed on Sunday night because I didn't see open holes for Ezekiel Elliott. I saw six-lane highways get opened in the Philly defense. Well, am I right about that?
Yeah, but here's the thing, though, Skip. On Monday night, you said this offensive line was overrated.
I didn't say it on Monday night.
Yes, you
did. I said before Monday night.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, after Monday night. On the previous Monday night, I thought it was horrible.
Oh, so
okay, but again, a big, what did I say? They got to get Connor Williams out of there, and all of a sudden, sorry, God, but he got hurt. He got hurt. I hope he's okay, but I don't want him back in the lineup.
Okay,
what did you see? Did you see gaping holes for Ezekiel Elliott?
But what I also saw is that when Zeke runs the football for 120 to 150,
thank you.
The offense looks good.
Thank you.
But what about the consistency? What happens when they turn that running water with Zeke Elliott off? Have you seen this year your guy deliver?
I haven't seen him under fire without Amari Cooper until Sunday night in Philadelphia.
Okay, what was Tennessee? Okay. Did he have Amari Cooper?
What about Tennessee? I'm glad you brought that up. Do you realize that was the first game with Amari Cooper? Do you realize the first three times Dallas had the football against Tennessee on Monday night football stage, they went zoom, zoom, zoom into the red zone and had three great chances to cash in a 21-0 lead?
Yeah.
And what happened? The field goal kicker misses a chip shot on the first one.
Yes, he did.
And again, they had first and 10 at the 23, and they got it to second and 4 at the 17.
Need the field goal kicker?
Well,
you
again,
your quarterback.
Okay, well, he throws a fade to Amari that I thought was just a bad throw.
Oh.
Okay. But he missed a chip shot. And then the second time they go down, and he does hit Amari for a touchdown, and they cashed. And the third time, I'll say it one more time, Dak Prescott made the single worst decision of his NFL career because they had second and goal at the 6-yard line.
Okay.
And he throws it to Kevin Byard, who goes and celebrates on the star, and that was the end of that game. But my point is, if you cash those in, if you score three touchdowns, this is Tennessee we're talking about.
Okay, since we
did. What did Tennessee